All right, excellent. Okay, so you are from Australia. Do you? Is there like an Australian Dota server?
Yeah, there is.
Oh, okay, cool. So you don't have to play on Southeast Asia. Great.
No, my ping's good. It's not an issue.
Okay, great. Okay, and you were 5.4K MMR, if I remember correctly?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, great. So you're past 5K, and you're basically at the point where, like, fundamental skills are no longer going to be, like, you know, your priority. Like, less hitting, spacing, positioning, stuff like that. And you need to focus. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, I think so. I think, I mean, that 90% true. There could be some points that you might be able to see that I'm still not doing well.
Right. Yeah, so basically what I'm saying is, like, you know, you can't just get better by just focusing on these things. You need to start thinking about, like, higher level stuff, like map pressure. You know, being in the right place at the right time, stuff like that.
Yeah.
So that's good. It's good in the sense that, you know, you've gotten past the fundamental wall. Like, you're past that point where, like, you know, you can be high MMR. But the hard part is that, you know, learning these other things is much more difficult.
Yeah, but I think for me, it's actually quite easy, like, because I always train myself to pick up those things as long as someone tells me. Like,
right.
If you tell me I'm doing this wrong or I need to start, like, a totally new concept or a concept I only partially understand, and you tell me about it, I think I can pick it up a lot quicker than other people.
Okay, cool. Okay, so I think first mistake already is...
Oh, you're watching the replay?
Oh, sorry, I didn't screen share. I'm so bad about that. All right.
Ah, okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
You see the screen share?
Yeah.
Okay. Let me know if there are, like, lag issues or whatever. And we can try restarting it.
I mean, it's a little bit slow, but it's watchable.
Yeah, no, I was watching it on the slow down thing. Or slowed down. It should be good now.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, it's better. It's watchable.
Okay. Okay, that's all that matters. Okay, so first mistake is item mistake. Like, automatically, the enemy team has an undying on their team. So that should signal to you that he wants to be in your lane, and he wants to make Slark not have a good time. And
I think now that I think about it, I was thinking Weaver, and I thought, oh, Weaver's going to hit me a lot. Yeah.
Well, even Weaver, it's better to start a salve and, like, a stout shield, rather than just go straight into PMS. Because you can always get the PMS at the side shop, but you can't always get regen there.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, that's mistake number one.
Cool. I'm just going to get a piece of paper. I'll be very quick.
Okay.
I got one now. Okay.
Okay, cool. Okay. I think this is, like, a team issue kind of thing. Like, it's not specifically on you, but maybe you could tell your team it's a bad idea. Basically, your heroes are just not that good at fighting at the room.
Well, the problem was we didn't have a sentry. I kept telling Rubik to buy a sentry. If we had a sentry, we would have killed bounty hunters so easy.
Right. So you're correct in that if you did have a sentry, then this would be a good play because you could just kill bounty hunter for free. But because you don't, it's a bad play to contest this, and you guys should just go bottom. Or your mid should just go bottom or whatever. Like, adapting to the situation is really important. Because you're not going to get teammates who listen to you in pubs sometimes, or you're not going to get people who do the correct thing.
Yeah.
Okay, so so you already started with, like, very little regen, and now you have 3 tangos left, and you're already at half HP. So this is, like, a disaster waiting to happen. Like, these guys have so many pressure heroes, you know, Bounty, Undying, Weaver. Like, you basically need a salve, like, really badly.
Yeah, I was already thinking, at this point, I was thinking Rubik is really weak in the lane, and I was thinking I could just solo this one. And I did solo this one. I told Rubik to go to a different lane.
Yeah, that's perfect. Yeah, that's 100% perfect. Basically, like, even if Rubik is here, you're basically just, like, going to have him soak at your XP. So you basically just want to get 6 as fast as you can. It sucks. You know, you want less hits on Slark, but this is the best you can do, I think, so it's fine.
Yeah. I've played Slark offlane as well, solo offlane, so I kind of just treated it as a solo offlane situation.
Yeah, that's a good approach to it. Now, I don't think you should pick Slark offlane, but I mean, you know, who am I to say that? But yeah, that's a good way to think of it for sure. That's a very healthy approach. Dire's top tower is under attack. Okay, you're looking at other lanes, that's good. I think you could be abusing the aggro trick a little bit. Like,
Yeah, I know how to do it, but I think I'll take damage. If there's a specific point you think I could do it?
Yeah, like, let's go back a little bit. Okay, so right here is an okay time, because, you know, your creeps will still be alive after this creep dies. And whenever Weaver goes for a last hit, you know, you can make him choose between hitting you and going for a last hit. So, like, right now you could drag the creeps back, because he basically has to go for this last hit, or he has to hit you.
Okay, yeah.
Okay, now, this is only true because, you know, you're not... Basically, you're not killable right now. If your HP was a bit lower, then you couldn't do that, because then he could just kill you instead of getting a last hit. And that's, you know, that's a great trade for him.
But I think that there's a chance he could kill me, because he can use... I think if he uses the bug and it latches on me, then the tower will hit the bug and it won't hit him, so he can dive me.
Yes, but he doesn't, that's true, but he doesn't have Geminate skills.
Yeah, and you can't tell that, but... I can tell that if I'm... Yeah,
you can if you're paying attention.
He's level 2.
Right. Yeah, like, you're given all the information to be able to infer that. Because he's Shikuchi'd at level 1.
Yeah.
Okay, so speeding up. It's a pretty boring lane. It sucks, but what can you do? You decide to buy some tangos, that's fine. So I think at this point... Oh, your pull is blocked too. Holy shit, okay. So, you can't pull, which really sucks, because, you know, that's usually how you survive in lane in these situations, is you just pull and bring the creep wave back. So you should be looking to pull this camp on the side. Now, if these guys are really good, they won't let you do this, but this is your only option, basically, to get reliable XP. Is right now you have an opportunity to run down here and pull. It looks like you stack. Or try to.
Because I don't have tangos. I think. That's why
Okay, so that's
it now.
Yeah. So there's not much you can do about that, other than maybe like plan for that. Like maybe save a tango rather than regen the full, so you can get XP later. But that's like next level stuff. Like that's super next level.
Yeah, that's really super next level. Yeah.
Yeah, but it's something you can do. It's like not unattainable.
Yeah.
Like if we're just thinking about it now, then that's something you could think of in game.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, so you did decide to pull. That's good. They didn't stop you as well. Great. You're going to get XP off this creep wave. Now, I'm pretty unfamiliar with Slark as a hero. Like, I get the gist of him. But I can't give you, like, nuanced item decisions. But, generally, my understanding of the hero is you just want, like, treads and an Aquila, maybe a wand, and then you want to go, like, a couple different routes, like the Shadowblade route, if you can kill a lot of heroes, which in this game it looks like you cannot. Like, I don't think this is a great Shadowblade game, especially since they have a bounty. So you can either do that, or you can go, like, Midas into Blink or something similar, or you can go S and Y. And I think I would go S and Y in this game.
Okay, my build is always Shadowblade.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah. When I was 4k, I was learning Slark from a friend, and he was 5.5k. He would almost always go Shadowblade, so I've just always played Shadowblade. And I can understand this game that SMY, actually thinking about it now, SMY could work. I probably wouldn't go Midas, but I could consider SMY.
Right. Yeah, I think that would be a good option in this game. And you can even go Shadowblade after SMY. Like, that's not a bad idea either, I don't think. Because, like, the Shadowblade kind of sucks against Bounty, but it's a really good item on Slark, because, like, you know, there's so much synergy with that and Shadow Dance. And it's, like, you're just naturally very good. I think that's an okay option as well.
I don't usually have that much problems against... I like Shadowblade because it forces people to buy sentries and dusts and...
Right.
I don't really mind. I play around it really well.
Okay, that's good.
Yeah, but it's good that you don't know Slark sometimes as well, because then you can focus on the bigger picture stuff.
Right. But yeah, I'm sure Shadowblade is like totally fine too. Like, I'd just be talking out of my ass with the SMY thing, but I think it's a good option too. So.
Yeah, it is. It is good.
Okay. Okay. I want to watch the setup for that.
I misclicked a bit, a little bit on the undying.
Okay. So there are a couple of things I saw there. Let's look at your player perspective. Okay, so number one was back here, where you went for the last hit. Basically, like, you should see that he's already charged, and I understand that you don't want to give away the gank, but there's an opportunity here where you could just start hitting him and start proccing Essence Shift. And, like, it's a little bit back here when you went for the last hit. Like, rather than going for this last hit, I think you could walk up like you were, you know, faking to go for it, and since he denied it, you could just start hitting him. And, like, that would be really good. And that would save you some time later on when he started running away with, like, a little bit of HP.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're
we only just got that kill and I died for it, too.
Right. So maybe if you went on him a little bit earlier, you would have not had the chase, and then you wouldn't have died. Or maybe you guys can turn on Weaver faster and kill him.
That's a really good point. It's, like, stuff I wouldn't catch if I watched it myself.
Right. That is what I'm here for. Glad I can help. Okay, so since they left your lane, like Weaver and Undying, you're doing the right thing by pushing. You want to create pressure as much as you can for your team. Also, doing this camp is great. It's very efficient. Good stuff. It might seem counterintuitive to, you know, want to attract people to your lane, but it's better than them, you know, getting T2 towers or whatever, because, like, you're a weak hero.
Yeah.
That's probably the best thing you can do for your team right now, is get people to TP top and, like, push the creep wave up.
Okay. I mean, I understand that concept, but I always feel upset when there's someone to stop me.
Yeah, I understand.
Because when someone stops me, if they don't stop me, I'll get the tower.
Right. Yeah, I mean, ideally, you just get the tower for free. Like, that's so good for your team. Like, that's maybe technically the best thing you could do. Other than, like, making kind of a PC.
That's what I'm trying to do.
Yeah. But it's good to make people TP.
Oh, okay, so right now, I leave the tower.
Right.
Because I see Weaver coming.
Let me see your player perspective to see. Let's go back. Okay, so you don't see anyone on the map right now. I think this is a fine choice. Like, you see Lone Druid and that's it. Like, it could be Bounty up there or whatever. It'd be too risky to go for the tower. Basically, even if there's nobody there, their tower is still taking some damage, and they're not farming that lane. So
yeah, often my playstyle, like, in this type of situation is, like, I'll push the tower, and then if I feel a bit of threat, I'll go to the jungle and keep farming.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's fine. It's better to trust your feelings at this point, I think. Like, there's a lot to be said about, you know, a player above 5k's intuition when it comes to this kind of thing, especially if you play a lot of carry. And I know I saw, like, 300 Slark games or something, so...
Yeah, I play a lot of carry because my wife plays support sometimes. So.
Oh, that's cute. Okay. Okay, so again, not much to talk about here. It's good that you made this guy come here, even though he's, you know, bullying you out of the lane, like, just by being there. I think he should have just fought you there. I don't know what he's doing, really.
Yeah, he, like, can fight me.
Yeah.
But he'll never kill me.
Right. But he can at least, like, get you low. I mean, it's not good because, like, you can just Shadow Dance to regen, but I think I would rather see him fight you and, like,
If I was Weaver, I would fight as well.
Yeah.
Because my feeling as Slark is, like, I'm pretty behind, and I don't want people to... Like, I don't want to die again, and I don't want... I don't want him to make me low so I waste time and have to regen.
Right. And also during that time, Bounty Hunter was not on the map. Like, you saw was the Weaver. So, like, if you just get to, like, 300 HP, and I'm assuming this guy is... Oh, he's level 5. Okay. And his skill build sucks. Okay.
He's 5.6.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, that's interesting. Well, I think his skill build sucks, but either way, you know, he can just show up when you get to a certain HP and just kill you, and he can't do much. If you're, like, busy fighting the Weaver or whatever, and you don't Shadow Dance in time. So that's something you have to be careful of. So I think it's a mistake for him not to fight. Okay, so this is, like, a weird situation, because, like, you want to naturally farm the jungle, but they have so many heroes that can invade, like Bounty Hunter, Ember Spirit, all of that. Right here, you should have noticed this ward. There was, like, a sliver of time where you could have seen that they had a ward placed. But you have to be actively watching the buff in order to see that. There's a little time. That's really helpful information for your team. It's a big part of Slark, I think.
Yeah, I think it's a big part of Slark. I mean, I do it, but it could be done more.
Right. Okay, so you're pressured by... It looks like you're dead if Ember has Slight. Oh, I messed up. Okay. Okay, that was a good play. Okay, great. Baited them into chasing you. I want to go watch, though. Let's go back. Okay, so it starts off by you fighting Weaver, and this time Bounty is there, so you know, instantly have to back up, and you recognize that. That's great. You Shadow Dance right away. I think that's a good decision as well, because you don't want to get chained. I think right here, if you get chained, you're in really big trouble.
Yeah, so I think I would have died.
Yeah, because even if you're Dark Pact, like, they're still going to be able to hit you a couple times. But, you know, he messed up. He took advantage of it. That's good. The pounce here was great. I go back off to regen. Okay, I think overall that this was totally fine. Yeah, and you have to be a little wary of Bounty Hunter as well. Okay, I don't have anything to say about that. I think that was good. I do think you were supposed to die there. Like, you know, if you were playing against superhumans or whatever, but...
Yeah, if nobody's playing in perfect place, yeah.
Yeah. Luckily, those do not exist, so you're good. Okay, was this your decision to smoke?
No, someone else.
Oh, okay.
Someone just smoked it.
Yeah, I think this was good.
This was really good. It got me... I got the kill.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I saved my pounce for the kill.
Yeah. Yeah, that's fine, by the way. Like, I mean... It would have been... It actually... It's optimal, I would say. It's like... just fine.
It's optimal.
Right. Because you're also, like, he was CC'd during that time, so you don't just want to pounce him randomly. You want to, like, extend the duration of your CC as much as possible. You don't need to just immediately pounce, because you're, like, wasting some of the tether time. So I would say it's, like, optimal. So, good stuff. Okay. See Undying mid. At this point, you should start to think that, like, maybe Bounty Hunter is running towards you. It's either if... So there's, like, a couple things that could happen here. Bounty Hunter and another hero, like Ember Spirit, could come bottom and pressure you. Or they're getting vision in their jungle. And I want to see what they're doing right now. Okay.
When you say they're getting vision in their jungle, do you mean in my jungle?
Yeah, in your jungle, sorry. So Bounty doesn't have any wards. But, I mean, they already have two wards up, so whatever. But you understand my point, right? Like, there's only a few things that you could be doing.
Yeah, I understand. So they're either in our jungle, or they're either looking for me, or they're in our jungle.
Right.
Or my jungle. Yeah.
Right.
So what goes through your head when you think about, like, what could be happening? Because I think you're a lot... It's a lot more, like, you think a lot more in-depth compared to me. Like, when I'm there, I'll think, oh, they're probably coming to... They're either coming to get me, or they're off doing something else. Like, I'm not thinking what else they could be doing. I'm just thinking whether or not they're coming to get me.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm not, like, going crazy in depth. Like, this is... I'm watching a replay here. Like, this is totally different from how I play. The possibilities in my mind do, like, you know, flash there for an instant. Like, I try to think of where they are, and maybe I'll think, like, okay, they're in our jungle, or they're here. And, like, I'll try to map them out on the map, like, in the fog.
Mm.
Do you understand what I mean?
Yeah, I do.
Okay, so that's basically what I do. I don't go super crazy in detail, like, oh, I think they're warding here, and, you know, they're dewarding this set exactly 24 seconds or whatever. Like, I don't go crazy like that. I think you'll find as like you get higher MMR and you start getting better and better, you'll start thinking like you'll start thinking of things like in much more simplified ways. Like they're going to come kill me is a totally fine way to think of it, like because that's what they're doing. You don't need to think about like all this other stuff. The only time it's important is if you're like a captain and you need to be able to like have options ready for your team. Like you need to have steps in place and you need to know what the counters to like what they're doing potentially are, so you're ready to call them out. That's like when it's important to know all of this extra stuff. But when you're just like a Slark carrier or whatever, you just need to know, am I dead? Are my teammates dead? No? Okay, good. Am I gonna die in a minute? Okay, maybe I should leave. That's like the gist of it.
That's what goes through my head.
Yeah, that's totally fine. Also, like, farming patterns and stuff too are important to think about, but that's
Yeah, at the moment my priority is to get my Shadow Blade as quick as possible.
Right, yeah, that's perfect. That's all you need to do. Okay. So because there are so many heroes top, you're free to farm all of this jungle, which is good. I think my ideal path is like doing all these camps leading up to mid and then hitting mid tower. It looks like you're gonna do that. Maybe you go back bottom?
No, I get the bounty rune.
Yeah, you get the bounty rune, that's fine.
Gets me my Shadow Blade.
Yeah, no, I think that's fine. I think you do go mid at this point though, and you like get some damage on this, because it will help.
I can remember that I probably never thought about mid.
Right. Well, that's a really important thing about carry. It's like pressuring the right places at the right time. Or like being in the place where the enemy team would hate seeing you. Like, man, that's so annoying. This guy's just pushing every lane at once. How's he doing this? But it's good that you're here for this fight. Good stuff. I think you could have been there even if you went mid. So that's not really an issue. Okay. I think your target selection is fine. You don't have detection, so you can't go for Weaver. I think this is a hard kill if he roars you after Dark Pact. Okay, he misses him.
I die here, actually. This is really bad. I should have chased him for so long.
Yeah, and he missed a pounce as well. Oh, he got rooted just to seal the deal. Alright, let's go back and watch.
I thought after I didn't get the kill, after he was just running around, I should just back and wait for the charge to kill him, because, you'll see.
Yep. Okay, so you lead with attack and then pounce. That's good. Wait, actually, did you? Did you attack first? I think you did.
Yeah, attack first, yeah.
Okay, you did good. Okay, that would have been horrible. That would have been, like, a very tragic way to miss the kill. So you're in an advantageous position here. Because, like, he had used his roar in a suboptimal way. Like, he basically wasted it.
I thought I could kill him with Dark Pack here.
Yeah.
And then it wasn't enough.
Okay. I'm gonna break out the Microsoft Paint for this. Okay. So right here. It's actually a little bit farther back. Shit. Alright. Okay. No pause. Alright. This'll do. Alright. Paint. Here we go. Okay. So, at this point you were like, let's just say you were a little bit back here, and he was right here. I'll use a different color for him. Lone Druid is red, and you are blue. Okay. So you were here, and he was running down. So there's only two possible ways he can go. Well, like, good possible ways. Like, he can either go to the left and kite this way, or to the right, or he can go straight, I guess, which is fine, but he'll die if he does that. He can also run back, but he'll die if he does that as well, so we can eliminate these two. So when you run in an arc like this, like if we watch again, which we will after, your pathing was like this. It was like very indecisive, and he took advantage of this by going to the right. Whereas if you just ran straight down, like down the middle, like very slight. It was a very slight difference here. You would have been able to hit him like no matter where he ran. Whereas when you took this little arc, like this tiny little detour, rather than the straight line, you missed out on the kill. Because one right click would have killed this guy. That's all you needed. So that was like a very slight fundamental thing. But it made a big difference.
I saw that. I saw how I was like wiggling around. But at the time, it was like it looked like he was going left, and then he started going right.
Mm-hmm.
So you would have just gone straight down?
Yeah, I believe so. Well, maybe I wouldn't. Maybe I would have made the same mechanical blunder or whatever. But that's, to me, looking like the optimal thing. And it looks like rather than clicking on the ground next to him, you just issued an attack command on him. Like, you right-clicked him. And that's also suboptimal. Like, you should be clicking very close to him, like right down the middle of this. Because you'll be able to attack, like, you know, in this small circle around him. Or around you. Rather than just in this small circle over here. So you're giving him options, basically. I feel like I'm not explaining this well, but do you understand what I mean?
Yeah, I understand. Like, I understand a bit of it.
Okay.
I understand a little bit. Like, I can close off his options a little bit.
Right. And I think to make a long story short and get rid of all that explanation, we can just say, oh fuck, I keep going too far. But either way, rather than right-clicking on him to chase, you should click on the ground next to him. Like,
I usually do that.
Yeah. And that made the difference in this case, because, like, you did the small arc, this arc movement, rather than the straight line. And naturally, that increased the amount of time it took for you to get to him, so you can attack him.
Yeah, okay, so you're saying I should click my movement, I should click nearer to him?
Right, or where you think he's going to go.
Yeah.
Like, basically, just make your route as direct as possible, so that you don't get messed up by the pathfinding.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. So, he ends up dying anyway, it looks like. Okay, good.
Yeah. But it wasn't good, guys. I didn't need to die.
Yeah, for sure. That was definitely a kill, I think. Maybe it's not a kill if he uses his roar properly. Right.
Yeah.
But, the second he used his roar improperly, it was a kill. Okay, either way, it's not the end of the world. You're still in a great position, I think. Even after having a really hard lane, so. You also bought dust, which I think is perfect. A lot of parries don't do this. It's good, though. I shouldn't chase here. Okay, that was a slight mistake.
Yeah, I died again.
Yep, okay.
He tricked me with his... he's got a wand, 100%,
right.
And I don't know if he's got mech or not.
Okay, I'll look.
But he heals a lot.
Yeah, he had a wand, and that's what healed him. But here's a mistake. I don't think you not getting the kill is a mistake. I think chasing here is a mistake, and you didn't check to see if you were tracked after you pounced. Whereas right here, after the creeps stop hitting you, you can Dark Pact and then Shadow Blade. And then I think you get out of this scot-free.
Yeah, like I didn't check. Yeah.
Right. And you need to be checking that like 24-7, basically. Like, that's your lifeline, your Shadow Blade. That's your way to get out.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah, because you definitely would have lived there. Or at least you would have had like a higher chance of living.
I would have lived if I got that Dark Pact into Shadow Blade off.
Yep. So those two deaths do matter quite a bit, because like the Slark is a snowball hero. I'm sure you know, you've played a lot of him.
Yeah.
But either way, it's not the end of the world. At the end of the day, like your hero is still very good at pushing. Or at least like killing creep waves, which is good.
Mm.
Okay, that's fine.
Middle tower is under attack.
I don't know about this. Okay, well. Okay, so it works out. I don't know if that was like a conceptually good play, because at the beginning they're so close to like the enemy's tower, and there's also an Ember Spirit with bots, so he can just be anywhere that Lone Druid is. And they also, you don't really know where Bounty Hunter is as well. Yeah, I can't say whether or not this is a good or bad play, but.
Yeah, I understand. When I went for it, I didn't consider the Beast of Travel Ember Spirit TPing onto a Spirit Bear. Yeah.
Yeah, and that's not like a huge issue for you, but it could become an issue. You know.
Yeah, it's just like when the fights drag on.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack. Okay, drops the tombstone. I think it's probably better to just pounce away right away, but maybe you don't have to. Okay, good target selection. Okay, I think that was completely fine. Okay, yeah, that was great. I'll watch it one more time to see if I see anything, but I didn't see anything, glaringly bad. Okay, no, I think that was fine. One thing I have noticed, like, just for this game as a whole, is it's hard to tell watching the replay, but it seems like you don't click on enemy heroes that often. Like, whenever they appear on the map. Like, I'll try to find an example later on. But it's really important on a hero like Slark, where, especially if you go Shadowblade, you need to, like, see every piece of detection that they have, like, as soon as the information is available to you. And that will make a huge difference in, like, how you make your decisions going into the game.
It's interesting, because I usually click supports, and I don't expect carries to have it.
Yeah.
So, because this game doesn't have that many, doesn't really have the core supports,
right,
and Bounty Hunter already has track, so I just think, they've got detection anyway.
yeah, you can't be lazy. Because, like, if they don't have detection, then you can go crazy, you can go super him, as long as you keep track of Dark Pact and track. So it's really important to click on everybody.
Yeah.
Also, it's just a good habit. Like, later on, you may be wanting to learn a hero that's really affected by Lincolns. Like, let's say you just decide to play Batrider. Then you need to click on every hero late game to see if they have a Lincolns or, like, a Yules or something. So it's a good habit just to, like, gather information as best as you can. That'll make everything about your game better.
Yeah.
Okay. That was fine. Yeah, it's good that you stopped chasing at that point. I don't think there was too much wrong with that. Obviously, it was a kill if you hit your pounce, but, you know, that's a useless thing to say. Like, man, you should hit your pounces. So, although, maybe this is, like, a mechanical thing. Like, similar to the Lone Druid kill that we missed.
Yeah, I think so as well.
Yeah, because it looks like
the tree.
Right, and it looks like you just clicked on him. Like, right-clicked, rather than clicking, like, close to your hero to line up your pounce.
I do that, but I guess sometimes it just, like, it's like when I know the pathing's gonna screw up, then I will,
right.
But I just didn't expect the pathing to screw up there.
yeah, that's understandable.
I think the pathing screwed up because I probably clicked in his direction, and because of the tree, it made me walk in. Yeah,
you walked, like, slightly around, so your hero had to turn.
Okay.
So maybe this isn't true, but I think it might be a good habit to just not rely on pathing at all, and just, like, manually aim your pounces, like, no matter what. Unless, like, the enemy hero is, like, hitting creeps or something, and, like, you're shadow-bladed next to them, in which case, it's easy.
I'm gonna go back and practice the pathing. Mm-hmm. But, like, practice this specific scenario.
Yeah, I think that's good. I think that is a good thing to do. What? Alright. I'm assuming he had a remnant out and it expired?
Yeah, that's what he said happened.
Okay.
I just thought I'd hit him, because I get stacks and I'll stop him from pressuring the tower.
Yeah, no, you did everything fine there. There's just there's no way that this hero dies in this situation. But, I mean, he did, so...
that was super cool.
Okay.
Because he was the most farmed.
Yeah, this is such a huge kill. That's so bad of him. Okay. You just get 12 that. Oh god. Alright. So his remnant expired and he can keep track of it. God. Alright. I can't get over that. The only thing you could have done here was check to see if his remnant was expiring or not, because you can see the buff. But I think you did fine. So
I
like
check it.
Right.
So if I click on him, you can tell if he has a remnant?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. You can it'll say like he has two remnants left or whatever, and it'll also say that he has an active remnant.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Okay. God. That was quite a kill. Okay, so you're rich. He just basically your entire bad laning phase against the Weaver and Dirge just got completely nullified, and you're filthy rich. So this game is great.
Yeah. It is kind of.
Yeah.
If I have a really good game, this is for me. I say I'm back onto a normal game,
right,
rather than I'm strong. I'm rich. Half again. Yeah, I'm still behind in that way.
Yep. Okay, the javelin thing I'm a little bit weirded out by, but I'm sure it's fine, like, now that I'm looking
getting,
at it.
I'm getting Basher.
Yeah. No, I think Basher is good against our heroes. I think you absolutely need an Abyssal, so it's fine. I've never actually bought a javelin, though, now that I think about it, and just had it in my inventory. That's interesting. I'm not sure if it's good or bad.
You always buy the full item? Oh, you're saying you're revealing the item?
No. I'm just not sure if, like, you know, when I go Basher or something, that I've ever both had a slot in my inventory that I wanted to give up for the javelin, or just not had the full Basher. Like, it's just, it's an odd scenario. I'm not familiar with it. I don't think it's good or bad, but yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so at this point in the game, you kind of want to, like, see what... or look at the enemy team's heroes and see what their big objectives are. Like, and to me, Roshan is pretty big because they have Lone Druid and Weaver. And, you know, they have Dirge as well to, like, control a fight that happens around there.
Yeah.
So maybe this is something you should scout beforehand, like, or just keep in the back of your mind. Like, if there are a lot of enemy heroes off the map or whatever, you know, maybe they're doing Rosh. It looks like they were, actually. Okay, nice, they were. I'm right. Excellent. But yeah, that's quite an important thing, and it'll affect your decision making as well. Okay, good, you focus the tomb. Okay, that was fine. Oh, your camera is in a bad spot here.
Ah, yeah.
Okay, good. I think you were doing your job there for the most part, but like I said about the camera thing, basically, like, right now, you don't need to be watching your hero. Like, you're a good enough player where you can see, like, or you can know where your hero is going to go just by, like, clicking on the minimap or whatever, and you'll know, like, exactly how they're going to move. So you can just watch the fight while it's happening. Like, you don't have to worry about...
I think what happened is, Okay, now it's bad, but before I wasn't regening, that's why I was like, they had a ward around, that's why.
Okay, yeah, that's actually fine then. Yeah, that's totally fine. You do understand my point though, like,
I do understand your point, yeah.
Okay, good. Okay, so you have your Basher complete. Basically, this gives you... Wait, do you? Yeah, you do. Alright, so now you just have a random chance to kill Ember or Weaver, which is great. Killing carries is good. Good stuff.
Yeah, I think about it as, like, I don't think I do. Like, I think Ember maybe, but I don't think Weaver I have a chance. I feel like Weaver's stronger this game, like, more HP this game. I keep telling Spirit Breaker to charge this. He's finally charging, but my invis ran out. So I have to start early.
Right. Yeah, and he uses Roar well. Not much you could have done there. Maybe since, like, this is a mind game thing. Oh, fuck. I don't know. Alright.
We could have got him. It's just my invis ran out and Spirit Breaker took too long to charge. If he didn't take so long to charge, then we could connect everything and he wouldn't get the Roar off.
Yeah, that's true. But what I was going to say was, since you've already had a situation where you've Dark Pacted, like, immediately after you attack Lone Druid from Invis, maybe you can mind game this guy into, like, Roaring right away. Or, into Roaring right away. And then you can delay your Dark Pact a little bit.
Yeah, I understand.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it purges the Roar rather than using Dark Pact right away.
Yeah.
Because, like, you already, you didn't quite condition this guy to use it. Use Roar right away, but do you see what I mean? Like, it's hard for me to explain for some reason.
I understand. Sometimes I play Lina. I used to play Lina with Yules, and I'll fake the stun when the Yules is dropping if I see they have a Yules themselves, because they're going to Yules straight away.
Yeah. Okay, that's such a good example, actually. Yeah. That's perfect. That's exactly what I mean. But that's something you can do with Dark Pact. I remember I played a lot of Sardar last patch, you know, because he was really strong, and I play offlane. So I remember playing against the Slark player that kept faking me out, and it was really annoying. Like, he kept changing up when he used Dark Pact after he pounced me.
Yeah, but, I understand.
I think that's really really important on this hero. Or maybe not really important, but, like, it's a cute thing you can do.
Yeah, it makes a difference.
Yeah.
Radiant structures are fortified. I'm top 100 Slaughter, by the way.
Are you?
Yeah.
Interesting.
Because I think I got there because I played it in an earlier patch when he wasn't strong and there's not many players playing it. And I play him as core, and so I get a lot of kills.
Makes sense.
Yeah. If I get a bash, he's dead.
He can get lifted. Hope he does. Nice. Okay, cool. Yeah, that was fun.
We're gonna do a summary at the end of the game and everything, right? Because I've got It's nearly 12 for me now, and I need to leave at 12:15, so we've got about 15 minutes.
Sure. Yeah, we can do that.
I'm really enjoying it, but yeah.
No, that's fine. I mean, that's coming to like about an hour anyway, so that's totally fine. We can just speed through this and talk about other stuff.
I think I played pretty well, but I lost the game at the end because I was pressuring a tower and they killed me. Okay. And I didn't have buyback because I used it.
Yeah, I think so far the big mistakes that I remember were the Lone Druid kill, where like your pathing was a little bit suboptimal. And other than that, I don't remember like any huge mistakes. I mean, there was this miss pounce here, which is kind of big, but... Alright, go ahead.
I've been climbing with Slark.
Yeah.
Just from watching the game, what... Like, do you feel like I'm 5.4, or, like, what do you think what level do you think I'm playing at?
I try to stay away from questions like this, because, like, number one, I don't really, you know how good Slark can actually be. Like, I don't know the limits of this hero. And plus, like, I think it's not good to say that somebody is playing above their level or whatever, because it will not only inflate their ego, but it might also distract them a little bit. So I'm not really sure. I would say that you're definitely playing, like, above 5k. Like, if I were to watch this game without knowing anything else, I would be able to tell.
Okay, good. Cool.
Yeah. Okay. So, at this point in the game, when they start pressuring your towers, it gets, like, a little tricky for Slark. Because you have to, like, really understand. Yeah, that's bad. But also, you really need to know when to go in, because like your decision is pretty final once you go in. Okay, and this looks pretty good. You lose the racks, so that's actually it's pretty rough. But I'll go back and watch a little bit. Okay, so I think the enemy team smokes in or something, or they go do rich. Okay, yeah, they go rich, then they go push. Okay, so at this point the game becomes rather hard, I think. I think your only option here is to, like, after they back off originally from bottom racks, you have to kind of assume that they're going to go rich, and maybe group up with your team or whatever, and try to contest it. Because once they get roached, it's like pretty easy for them to just like throw themselves at your racks.
Yeah.
Like you don't have a exceptionally good wave clearing heroes. Like you have Lina and Rubick who are great, but they're not going to stop a full-on push with like Londra's Necro and Bear and everything. Plus yeah. Bounty Hunter can mech the wave, so.
Yeah.
Okay. So I think the play there was to just try to contest Roche and use the information they gave you to make that decision.
My camera, I got a quick, like, so I'm not watching the racks and stuff, I'm just going on these two guys at the back.
Yeah, it's very centered around your hero and your target, whereas you need to be taking in, like, all of this information here. Like, you're not getting you're not seeing the forest, basically. You're blinded by these trees. I don't know if you've heard that expression, like, you can't see the forest for the trees, or whatever it is. Yeah. Yeah. I probably used it incorrectly, but whatever. Language
I understand though. So my camera, I mean, even if I took a quick look before I went in, probably would have been better.
Yeah, that would have been great. Even if you don't consciously process the information, intuition is a really cool thing. It's like your subconscious and your conscious mind communicating.
Yeah.
So you'll be able to, you know, gather information subconsciously, and that will help you make decisions even if you don't realize it. Okay, so you guys win the team fight, but you do lose your axe, and against a lone druid hero, that is terrifying. It's like they
This lone druid's not good though.
Yeah, well, the thing is, he doesn't have to be good. Like, all he has to do is press his nice battle cry button, and then hit your towers, and you either glyph, or you lose your base, or you kill him. Those are the three options. Especially since he went this like crazy Necro of Laz builds, like that's actually insane. I've never seen anyone do something like this, but it's good for pushing, so whatever. Okay. I'm not sure there's a lot to learn from the rest of this game, but I think now is a good time to like ask any questions you may have about like practice or general theory, just stuff about Dota in general.
What do you think? Could you list like three areas that I could improve on, but big picture stuff?
Big picture stuff. Okay. Sure. So let's get a nice Microsoft Paint here. Erase all this. How do I make the brush bigger? Okay, we're gonna make a new one. Basically, big picture stuff for carries are like map pressure, and everything that goes along with this, like creep waves, controlling all the creep waves, cutting off creep waves when the enemy team is pushing, stuff like that, being in the right place at the right time. Like, remember when you ran to get the bounty rune and then you ran to the fight rather than pushing mid, or getting the bounty rune then going mid then going to the fight. Like that, stuff like that is pretty big. What else? This isn't really big picture, but it's something that like we noticed a couple times in this game. Was a fundamental skill, like I want to say it was just mouse movement. Like where you were clicking on heroes rather than clicking on the ground to aim your pounces. And I think it's better to just like manually aim your pounces rather than go for like the padding pounce.
Yeah.
For a third one. Let's see. I can't think of any, like, really big picture things, but it did seem like you weren't really prepared for what the enemy would do sometimes. Like, this rush fight here.
Yeah.
Was the big one. But I think this is an important thing for a carry. But I guess we can write that down. Like, let's say, yeah, this is fine.
Yeah, it's like, I guess these questions are leading up to what separates me from being 6K.
Well, that's hard to answer from just one game, but usually it's decision making and like being consistent. I would say the most important thing is consistency. Like, if you had games like this every game where, like, you know, you get kills out of a bad lane, like you start off in a really bad lane against like hard enemy heroes, and then you end up doing well anyway, I think you would be 6k in no time. Like, I think that's 100% true. But I'm sure there are games where, like, you don't play as well as this, or maybe you play like 80% as well as you usually do, and that will cause you to lose. Whereas if you played 90 or 100%, then, you know, you would win that game. So I think consistency is the biggest thing, actually.
Yeah, I feel like I've been playing when I wake up, and I lost two games in a row, and I feel like that I'm not awake enough yet.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's not much you can do about that. I mean, you can, like, exercise before you play or something like that to get your blood flowing, or, like, have a cup of coffee or something. I mean, I don't really have much to offer there. Maybe if it's possible, you can try to play more. Like, I know you have a business thing going on, so that's tough.
Yeah.
But, yeah. Since you're... If you have games like this a lot, then naturally you'll just gain MMR, and you don't have to worry so much. Like, how long have you been 5.4K?
Just recently. I can't... I played... I was 4K solo, 5.7K. Mm-hmm. I was 4.7K party for a long time, and then then I climbed to 5K, and then I stayed there for a while, and I thought, because I was just like, oh, I got 5K, I'm pretty happy. And then I started playing again, I thought, maybe I can go higher.
Yeah.
And it's probably in the last month that my win rate's been pretty high, maybe 70%, I've been getting going up. So I only just got 5.4K maybe in the last week.
Okay.
And if I keep playing, then I'm hoping I'll keep going up.
Yeah, so
I don't know when I'll stop.
Like, from what I've seen, just from this game, and this could be wrong, but it just seems like what's separating you from 6K players is just time and, like, games played. Like, I think if you played 100 more games after this, and you play, like, maybe 60% of the games, you play as well as this, and, like, the other 40, you play, like, 80% as well as this, or something like that, then I think you could get 6K. Like,
only on Slark, though. I think it's
that's a big thing,
like,
actually.
I think if I play other heroes, it's weird. Like, I'm top 100 Slaughter. I'm not confident on Slaughter playing this level, unless I feel like it's suiting the lineup, like our team composition.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. Like, Slark is a very unique hero, and he's actually, for this reason, I don't recommend him to newer players. I think it's fine that, like, you're playing him, because, you know, you've gotten to 5.4K playing him. You obviously have the mechanics to use him well, so I think that's fine. But I do recommend that you, like, branch out a little bit and play some other, like, simple carry heroes. Like, maybe try to learn Juggernaut a bit well.
Yeah.
Or
I mean, I can play him because he's, as you say, he's simple, but...
Right.
Do you feel that if you play a hero like Slark, you can trick people and... Because people don't understand the hero as well as you do, whereas Juggernaut, people kind of just know the hero because he's so easy.
Yes and no. I mean, you can trick people with Jug too. Like, there are so many mind games with Blade Fury, like baiting spells and stuff, or baiting spells with Ame Slash. Like, there are a lot of nuances to Juggernaut that are similar to Slark's. You can also bait people with Healing Ward.
I'm really bad at controlling the hero Healing Ward.
Yeah, like I'm confident to say that, like, you can't be a master of both Slark and Juggernaut if you're not, like, you know, 7K or a professional player or whatever. If you're a master of like two or three heroes, then I think you could like be a professional player. But you have to understand that mastery is something like, it's crazy. That means you're insane at the hero. Like, you can't get better.
Yeah, it's like Admiral Bulldog.
Yeah, actually, he's a good example. Like, he was famous for playing two heroes, and he was just really good at two heroes. But he was so good at them that he could get away with it. But yeah, that's I do recommend adding a couple heroes to your pool. Like, it's okay to climb with Slark, because it's not like your 6k would be fake or whatever if you got 6k playing Slark. Like, you still have it. But for you as a player, I think it's good to start branching out a little bit.
Mm.
I think that would really benefit you, actually.
I know all the heroes, but right. Having not, because I played for like 10 years, but having right. not played them in a long time, and I think when you play to 5.4k, if you're playing those heroes, you really need to know them really well, or you won't be able to play at that level.
Yeah, well, I think it's different for everybody, but I think you seem to be the kind of person who likes playing the same thing over and over again and just getting better at the nuances of the hero.
Yeah.
Or at least that's what I'm gathering here. Maybe I could be wrong. But yeah, no, you're not wrong.
I just think some heroes take... it's going to take me more time, and then I'm going to get weaker. I don't have enough time to play the games.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that becomes tricky for sure.
I'm here. Playing Spec. What do you think of Spectre?
I think that's a great decision, actually. I think she's like a very mechanically simple hero, but a lot of the decisions you make really affect the game. So I think that's good.
You can see I play Slaughter. I used to play Storm. And I can still play Lina. I don't feel like Lina is as strong as before.
Right.
Yeah, I think Conker's really weak now, even though I played it at the start in like 4k times, and I used to play that.
Yeah. I think Conker's my favorite hero, actually, personally. But
really?
Yeah. I play him offline, though, and I play him like with a mech and arcane boots and stuff. Like, I don't play him as a right-clicker.
Yeah.
He's interesting. But either way, I think like if you don't have a lot of games or a lot of time to play, then... Just adding one additional hero, I think, is reasonable.
Well, like, Slaughter is... I can still go to him. Like, I'm really familiar with Slaughter being top 100. It's just, but I don't play him offlane. And I feel like my Slaughter really relies on...
Right.
It relies on people who split push on the other team, and also my team providing me good support. Because Slaughter, from my playstyles, I can't catch up when I play Slaughter through... when I play Slark, I can jungle and catch up. But Slaughter, I can't farm as like that.
Yeah, that's true. That's kind of why I recommend, you know, Juggernaut. Like, he's my go-to hero if somebody wants to learn another hero or whatever, and they don't know him. Because he can do, like, pretty much everything. But, I don't know. This isn't something that you have to do. I think you'll be fine if you just play Slark. But I think if you want, like, to improve as a player, then you should start adding heroes to your hero pool, you know, slowly as time goes on. Like, just add Juggernaut. Maybe for 6 months you just play Slark and Juggernaut, and like, you know, the odd game of whatever, like maybe a Sardar game or two. But I think you should slowly start expanding your hero pool, and that will slowly increase your game understanding as well.
Yeah,
so I think that's what I would focus on right now.
Okay.
Also, when I say this, I also mean don't neglect the fundamentals as well. Like the pathing thing we were talking about earlier with Pounce.
Yeah. Oh, you were going to say something about... You were mentioning something in your post.
Mm-hmm.
You're really good at games, and there are fundamental skills for all games.
Right.
So, like, are you the kind of person where you play a game and you just become really good at it very quickly?
Well, now I am, yeah. Before it wasn't the case, but, like, I played so many different video games that, like, I kind of get the gist of the game very quickly.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it doesn't take me long to figure out really basic stuff, whereas it might take another person really long. So I can start, you know, just grinding out those things. And, like, for me, I got good at Dota by, like, just practicing last hitting and, you know, thinking about macro game, like, movements on the map, like, pressuring at the right times. I also had some knowledge from League of Legends. I played that, like, semi-competitively or whatever. So like I kind of understood like very basic MOBA mechanics.
Okay.
So I didn't have to focus on that when I started playing Dota.
Yeah. Okay. I gotta go now.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Yeah. No problem, dude.
I'm gonna review what my notes and everything, and I think I've got a lot.
Okay. Also, I upload like all of my sessions to YouTube, so I'll be uploading this one.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Well, excellent. Thank you for your time. If you ever
I can watch it again. That's so cool. I can watch it again. Ah. Oh,
yep.
Amazing.
Yep. All right, that's good. I'm glad you appreciate it. That makes me feel good. If you have like questions about Dota or whatever, just feel free to like message me on Skype. That's cool.
Yeah.
Like I don't bite.
Thanks.
All right.
Thanks, man. Okay.
All right. Good luck. Have fun shopping.
Okay. See ya.
Peace.